then runners cross the finish line of a marathon and collapse on the floor. Nobody looks at them and thinks that they were physically unfit. They just think they pushed really hard. Last year, I got one of those 24-hour bugs. I don't think I've had one of those in more than a decade, easily. And my husband got it too. And when my husband got it, people said, "Sorry to hear you're ill. You know, oh, that's bad luck." When I got it, people said, "You shouldn't work so hard. You should have a better work-life balance. You should, you know, like it was my fault." I think people can feel uncomfortable with the way I work. I don't want the way I am to make people feel uncomfortable. When the runner crosses the finish line and collapses, you don't think that they were physically unfit. So you might have seen the video that I did just after my Viva. You probably can't see it now because I hid it. And you could see what hard time I was having as I tried to fit into systems that are not designed with me in mind. And that everybody finds difficult, but I just can't do. And there were various other things happening. One that I'd say, but it's so and then you would have seen a lot of pictures of the back of me, or pictures of me spending time with my children. Not so many of the PhD life, staring at books, pictures. So I've been signed off from the PhD. Sick. And I apologise if any of the language that I use is offensive to anybody. It's the language I use for myself, and I know that within disability I pay close attention to the language changes, and I hope that I'm reasonably up to date, and with this I have no awareness of it at all, and so I'm probably hideously out of date. So these are just my words, and they could easily be the wrong words. So I was signed off sick because I went mad. And I was saying to my husband, it's weird, I was insane, but not mentally ill. And I know that sounds like an oxymoron, but, you know, like, I've been depressed. Everybody has mental health in the way that they have physical health, so I've been depressed before. And I know that you can hear that the thoughts in your head are wrong, that you're thinking in a way that's identifiably like a bad idea. And I wasn't thinking wrong at all. My thoughts were all still really clear and lucid. But I stopped being able to see. Or I couldn't reliably see. You know how if you close your eyes sometimes to think of something, or you close your eyes to concentrate? It was like that. But my head was doing it to me. I had my eyes open, I was trying to see, but I I couldn't, I was thinking too loud to be able to see. And then the other thing that happened was I had conversations without realizing. And so, you know how there's things you think in your head and then, you know, that you don't say out loud, edit out. And the conversations that you do have out loud. And for me, as an autistic person, I live in the world where the social conventions are built around a neurotype I don't own. So I probably have more, the conversations in my head are probably more atypical. I don't know. But ordinarily I have conversations that I'm having in my head and then the conversation that I'm having out loud. And they feed into each other, but I'm careful to make sure that the right one is out loud. And I was having this conversation in my head with somebody. And I was also struggling to see. And then I was looking at them and thinking, like, their mouth seems to be moving. And you have to really kind of concentrate to look, like, make sure out of all the information that's going around in your head that you pay attention to the looking. And I was really looking at them and they looked like they were saying their part in my head conversation. And then I was looking more and then I realised that I was having the in my head conversation out loud. It was going fine. But I have no idea how long I was having that conversation for. So that's not okay. You've lost your marbles. And it's an oddly ordinary narrative in doctoral work. In fact, the first induction lecture that I went to said, you know, in big bold letters, look after your mental health. And various people sort of spoke about mental health as a part of, there's a kind of presumption that you'll lose your mental health whilst doing a PhD. And I had that experience just recently. And you think, oh, I didn't lose my mental health. My thoughts were still really lucid. I just exhausted. I pushed for the finish line and I've collapsed before the finish line. I went mad, but not because I was ill, not because I'd got poor mental health, but just I've done too much thinking. And you don't want to say because everybody, well, because you worry that people will turn around and say you shouldn't work like that. And I have all sorts of answers to that in my head. I can't work like anything else. The idea of a work-life balance is based on the idea that work and life are two different things. And I don't think that idea is helpful. I live whilst I'm at work and I would want to do a work that I was happy to live in. And so I don't think it's work bad and life good. And there's a privilege in that, isn't there? It's assuming that we've all got lovely home lives, which I do now, but I've not always had. And it's assuming that people get to have a home life. There's plenty of people who are working at all the jobs just to survive. So it's that idea of a work-life balance is very much a position of privilege. And it's also a presumption of a norm that's not my norm. Either switching between work and life, that switch is really hard. If I wanted the sort of mental health that people get from having a good work-life balance, I would just work. But I have a lot of life, a very lovely life, but it's not easy. There isn't anything else I can do. I'm good at the thinking bit. Maybe not finish line good, but you know, I've run a good race so far. I'm not good at a lot of the other bits. And I'm constantly bewildered by and in awe of the people who are. But mostly, in all of it, in the online world, standing at the school gates, you know, in my friends, I'm just looking at people. And thinking how extraordinary they are and how sort of dazzlingly, you know, like I live in Cornwall and you get to walk along the coastline and some days in the summer the light from the sun on the sea is so bright it hurts your eyes. The sea sparkles that much that it hurts. And people to me are like that. They are so just blindingly, breathtakingly, staggeringly brilliant. And the stories that I see through my work and the lives that I get to witness through the little window of social media, they're more than everything. And the specific work, you know, this particular race that I've entered, the end goal of this race, the point of my doctoral studies, is to say that these people have equal value to us and that they should be heard or known in research for their own benefit, sure, but for the benefit of everybody. And I think it sort of honours humanity to do that. And I'm so in awe of the humans I see. So I've got to start the race again. And then to switch an analogy, it's the plate spinning one, isn't it? People say, I don't know how you do so much. That is a phrase I hear a lot. Along with you should have a work-life balance. I'm not a fan of that one. They're like, I don't know how you do so much. And the answer to how you do so much is by doing it. Like, once you have all the plates spinning, once they're all up, keeping them spinning is so much less effort than getting them all spinning. And when I lost my marbles the other week, I dropped a couple. And then the ones that drop trip you up as you run around and it just all... it spirals down very fast and you're very quickly not a capable person. And I lose access to language fairly regularly, just in, you know, life. It just sort of runs out. It's like I have a limited supply of it, and I have to pay attention to keep my mental health good, just like I have to pay attention to keep my physical health good. You know, I feel very human. I don't feel brilliant. I definitely don't feel inspiring. And once you drop a few plates, you can't keep the rest up. And then the world gets very, very big and very frightening. And I'm middle-aged, which means lots of things rely on me. Things, children, family, pets. But that spiral flips the other way. I was talking to somebody this week who has a daughter, an autistic daughter, and there was a list of things that they'd not been able to do. And you listen for longer and you hear about this young woman. And she didn't sound like an incapable person to me. She just sounded like somebody whose plates had all dropped, and if you could get her into a situation, like the spiral up, once you find your place and find the bit of the world that you can do, you don't have to be able to do the whole world, at least I hope you don't. Once you find the bit that you can do, you're like, that's the bit you can do, the spiral goes up. And I see a lot of people for whom the spiral's going down, and that downwardness is something that they blame on themselves or other people think is a part of them. But this is too long now. I'm trying really hard to be sane, because I would like to finish the doctorate, the PhD. I think it's worth doing. I'm not going to do very much with it, but it's just a little nudge to say, have you seen these people? Like, have you seen these humans? In this little window that I watch you through, maybe you watch me. I see you.